Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Frame Rate is brought to you by Pond5, the world's stock media marketplace. If you're a media maker who needs stock video clips, photos, illustrations, music tracks, or sound effects, check out Pond5 for instant downloads at the best prices anywhere. Check out Pond5 at Pond5.com. And for 25% off this month, use code TWIT25.
You know how sometimes you want to use a song in a YouTube video, but you can't because it's copyrighted? And you know how sometimes that song is just so poignantly ingrained into our culture and has been for so long that really it has no business being copyrighted anymore? Like, well, I can't think of a specific example right now, but my point is this. I just wrote a song that I think people should be able to use whenever they want, however they want. I wrote it to the tune of Good Morning to You, which is in the public domain. I hope you like it. It's just a quick little ditty about an Egyptian river god who finds a place to sleep atop two sheep and a deer named Harrison, who also happened to be governors of Algiers before the French conquest in 1830. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Harrison. Happy birthday to you. There you go. And like I said, use it whenever you want because both the melody and the lyrics are free of copyright.
Oh, you know what it is. It's frame rate.
Frame rate!
It's not like you didn't know it was frame rate. And welcome to Frame Rate. I'm Tom Merritt.
Hey, I'm Brian Brushman. If I sound terrible, it's because I'm at a hotel.
And they and only have Wi-Fi at your hotel, right?
Only well, Wi-Fi. No, actually, I have a rare esophageal condition that causes me to sound terrible.
Oh, okay. It's called hotel Wi-Fi-itis. And it's caused by...
Yes, exactly. I have a doctor's note.
By way of explanation, that opening video... happy birthday, the song about wishing you a happy day of your birth, is copyrighted, and the family is very litigious about the use of it. That's why you hear horrible songs in restaurants that are like, it's your birthday, happy TGI Fridays, that, you know, drive everyone crazy, because they don't want to have to pay the licensing rights to sing the actual happy birthday song, but he had a clever way of getting around it.
Yeah, I wonder, from what I understand, he had his lyrics and approved them. So I wonder if this could be like a genuine test case. I wonder if he's going to get any flack from that family.
Yeah, well, and you could adapt his song. If, say, you knew a deer named Brian or a deer named Jason, you could just say, you know, happy birthday, deer Jason or deer. You know, you just change the name of the deer, customize it.
Well, yeah, I think the name of the deer is adaptable. I'm sorry if I said Frühstück, by the way.
You sorry about Frühstück?
Yes, I said I'm sorry if I'm doing a Max Headroom impression right now. It looks like my signal's degrading.
Stop moving around. Skype doesn't like it when you move. Let's start off with the big story.
All right.
This just in, the big story.
We are moving times. Actually, we got another big story. But just so you know, if you watch Frame Rate live and you're wondering where did that frame rate go, this is the last frame rate we are recording at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. Starting next week, we are moving times to 10 a.m. Pacific, which is 1 p.m. Eastern.
Yes. So eat that, sirs.
Yeah.
Really have an opinion on this one way or the other.
Okay. What about
it'll be interesting to see whether or not everything fits in.
I don't have an opinion, but let me tell you my opinion. Because with the extra delay we get from the hotel Wi-Fi, that makes the show real smooth. No,
All right, that's it. I'm going invisible. I'm going to remain in stealth mode. I'm audio only now. So tell me if the bandwidth gets any better.
He is a magician.
I don't even know how he did
that. He just went invisible. It totally did, though. The audio got great.
I'll just be audio only, and I'll turn on the video if I have something important to show you.
I'll work on a screenshot.
All right. Exactly. Our actual big story is not just the time change, but women like watching video on the web more than men do, according to a Nielsen study. It says 57% of Netflix.com visitors are women, and 59% of Hulu visitors are women. I believe that means that the remainder of the 100% are then men. I'm not sure if they have a third gender.
So I am going to say something that may be sexist. I don't know. But I have a theory about this. And the theory is dishes. And the reason I ask is because as soon as I saw this story, I said, I wonder if it's me. Because my wife watches Hulu every single time she does the dishes. And I asked my friend Nate Staniforth, and he says he watches it while he does the dishes. And I'm betting that more often than not, ladies do the dishes more than men. Not that that's a value judgment one way or the other. I'm just saying I predict that's how it is, and I think that affects it.
I do the dishes, and I don't watch Hulu or Netflix when I do them.
Freak.
I know what you're trying to say. You're not trying to say it's women's job to do the dishes. You're saying that,
right,
you know, due to whatever sociological history we have, it may still be possible that women do dishes more often than men. And therefore, if they watch Hulu and Netflix while they're doing dishes, that might account for this. I think that's
not just dishes, but like a little bit of menial work in general. You know, like if you do the laundry or sorting clothes or whatever. Like these are all time.
I do all that stuff. I vacuum. I do laundry. I do dishes. I never watch Netflix or Hulu. I watch Netflix or Hulu when I'm sitting down and can watch. I listen to audiobooks when I do all that other stuff.
See, like I see Hulu for me. That's the ephemera that I want on while I'm doing other stuff. But the Netflix is a sit down experience for me.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it may be because of the kind of content available. That would be my guess. I don't have any evidence for that. I'm just saying it may be that the content that's available on Hulu and Netflix just happens to appeal to women more than it does to men by whatever chance of licensing, selection, etc.
Anyway. Yeah. Well, either way, I think both of us agree that this is just an artifact of no discernible bias. There's nothing inherently ladylike about Netflix or Hulu, I don't think.
No, I don't think so either. It's just one of those quirks. And it's not so big of a gap that it couldn't be explained just by random variation.
Right, right.
Let's move on to another big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
So Reed Hastings today, CEO of Netflix, was giving a speech in San Francisco at a tech conference, walked off stage, didn't say anything crazy. As Greg Sandoval at CNET says, public relations team must have been breathing a sigh of relief. But minutes before wrapping up an onstage interview, Hastings made the following remark. He was asked whether the cable companies are pressured by the enormous amount of traffic that Netflix customers generate. Hastings sarcastically said, "That 92% Comcast operating margin is really under pressure. There is no pressure."
I got to agree with them. And if there is, this is not a case where Netflix is driving increased use of the internet. It's just a most popular destination for people on the internet. And let's say they had a third of all internet traffic. Does that suddenly make it okay for a cable company to try to install an extra toll on people going there?
Well, but this whole thing is misunderstood and misrepresented, and I don't think Reed Hastings made it any better with that comment. Oh, 93% operating margins has nothing to do with bandwidth. They may have great profit margins and still have real network congestion problems. Those two aren't necessarily linked. What he's talking about is the fact that Comcast is charging level 3 for Netflix's traffic coming into Comcast's area. And I've talked to a lot of people in the industry. If you are an ISP who is also a telco or a cable company, you are bending over backwards to try to figure out a way to monetize every person who you have in your audience. Whether you call it eyeballs or just customers, they are trying. The currency of the internet are people right now, not money. This isn't about profit margins. This is about, I want to own the people in charge for them. They use my service. And the way that, peering has worked up till now, if you're an ISP who just does a backbone or you're a CDN which just does the content, that's not the way you approach it at all. You're actually selling bandwidth. So when Comcast complains Netflix is using up all the bandwidth, that's a crock. That's not what's going on. Comcast is trying to monetize the people that Netflix is reaching in the Comcast network. They're trying to own the audience that subscribes to their service.
Do you think that this will backlash on them, this effort to try to position position themselves as victims of some sort?
No, because people don't. It's too complex. I mean, the way that I just the way that I just described it probably doesn't make sense to a lot of people. But what does make sense is you're using a lot of Netflix, and that uses up all the bits, even though there's a bottomless number of bits. That doesn't make any sense at all, but it makes common sense. And that wins that wins public relations arguments.
Well, I guess related to this is the story about Netflix will one day be part of your cable bundle. What's the story on this one?
Yeah, so this I think this is at the same conference, the Morgan Stanley Technology Conference. He says it's not in the short term, but it's the natural direction for us. Many cable providers would like to have a competitor to HBO, and they would bid us off of HBO. So he's saying, you know, we're a better choice for smaller cable companies because they don't have to pay the premium of HBO. They could just pay the equivalent, probably a discount on the $7.99 a month, and package Netflix in as part of their cable service. And that's an interesting take, especially in the light of what Comcast is doing with its Streamfinity or whatever that Streamium service. They have that they're bundling in, which is Comcast is basically showing like, yes, absolutely. That's what we're doing. We're going to provide a Netflix-like service to our customers. Maybe Cablevision doesn't want to go out and create all those deals and bend over backwards like Comcast is to create it from the ground up. They might contract with Netflix down the road.
I'll tell you the biggest reason I think this will definitely happen is because more than anything, the cable companies, I assume, want to keep that $80 a month pipeline coming in. They want people to have a fat subscription. And if they can figure out a way to piece by piece start switching over their bandwidth from the current setup into a more on-demand configuration and still preserve that $80 a month fat pipe of cash, then it seems like they're going to do – that is a compromise that I think they're going to be okay with. And Netflix would do well to work with them to make that happen.
Well, and now that Netflix is, you know, finally venturing into original content, it's the kind of thing that the cable company can have an easier time selling to its audience. Like, hey, this isn't just a streaming service. This is a place to watch things you can't watch anywhere else. So why would you go to Verizon or AT&T when you can come to Cablevision or Time Warner and get the same stuff? But believe me, Time Warner is a horrible example. They badmouth Netflix every chance they get. They're not going to be the first people to do this. They'll be the last. But it, you know, smaller cable companies could see Netflix as a great partner. It's an interesting thing to hear Reed Hastings talking about.
Thank goodness that's the very last story about Netflix that we're going to have this entire day.
Yeah, let's move on to yet another big story. Wait. Ryan.
Tuck in your bootstraps. It's yet another big story.
I didn't think we had yet another big story, and then I looked down, and it's a story about Netflix that you put in.
Oh, it's almost as though I tricked you, Tom Meritz.
You scammer.
I am but a very prankster. yeah, so you know the Starz Play movies are about to disappear. Now, is this a long-term, like, Starz and Netflix are done forever, or is this like they're going to kiss and make up later on at the party and we'll catch them in the closet?
Anybody's guess. Right now, it does not look like they're going to get back together anytime soon.
So we've known this story was coming for a while, but then it really hit me today when I looked at TV and Movies Now, created a list of all the Starz content that's expiring. And these are some great, you know, for all the talk about Netflix not having top movies, we got Toy Story 3, Howl's Moving Castle, Tangled,
Mars
Spartacus.
Needs Moms.
Dude, there's so many big titles here.
Airport.
Vertigo. Peter Pan, Lethal Weapon 2.
In His Father's Shoes.
A Christmas Family, of course, now I'm getting dead. Tron Legacy.
Broken Lance.
He's going away. I love Netflix.
Perry Mason.
See, like, Tron Legacy is one I would never... Tron Legacy I would never buy, but since it was on Netflix, I would love calling it up just to make my point about how boring it is anymore.
Yeah, it's
what's a Sherlock Holmes stuff.
You know, it's one of those things where it's a bit of perception, right? You look at this huge list on TVandMoviesNow.com, and you're like, whoa, Netflix is losing everything. But the fact of the matter is, that's just 840 movies.
And, yeah, and Netflix has
thousands of movies still in their catalog. Plus, New York Times has a story.
Tango and Cash. Tango and Cash is going away. How do you deal with this?
Beetlejuice is going away. No, and I bet it's a much longer list that what Netflix didn't have before it's today, right? I mean, they don't have a lot. Right. They don't. There's tons of stuff they don't have, and they're getting new deals and adding things all the time. Stars going away is not going to kill Netflix. However, New York Times does have an interesting article pointing out that TV series now account for more than half of the Netflix viewing, not the offering. It's not about what's available. It's about what people watch. So sure, they were watching some of the Star stuff, but Reed Hastings has said over and over, Stars accounts for less than a few percentage points of the content that people watch. And it seems that people are watching old television shows on Netflix.
Well, and I think that's the right thing. And keep in mind also, if you're talking about actual viewership data, that's going to be different because you watch a movie once, that's 2 hours and you're done. But like, I'm still plowing through Lilyhammer and I'm four episodes in, still have four to go. So inherently, it makes sense that when you dive into a series, you'll be going through it a lot longer and you'll spend a lot more viewing time watching a TV series than you would for just a movie.
And what do you think Netflix wants? Higher viewing time or lower viewing time?
Higher viewing time,
yeah,
Tom?
Exactly. I mean, yeah, exactly. So, you know, TV shows are worth it for them to bend over backwards to keep and to add and to have a larger selection of. And they can get by losing Stars if the deal doesn't make sense financially for them right now. Their stock is in the toilet with the Stars deal expiring because everybody's looking at that list of 840 movies like you are going, oh, it's Toy Stories 2. They're losing huge things. But in practice, if somebody isn't primed by that, to think Netflix selection goes down, I wonder how much they're really going to notice when they fire up Netflix and start looking for something to watch.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, man, I don't think I have anything else to chime in on that.
All right, let's take a look at our sponsor. Very happy to have this sponsor on Frame Rate. This episode is brought to you by Pond5, the world's stock media marketplace. And I know a lot of folks in this audience, they watch Frame Rate because they're making stuff for the internet. And they want to know where the people are watching things, how they can watch things off the internet. And Pond5 is great for folks who make media. If you're a blogger, if you're making video, you're making films, you're making apps, you need clip art, you need video, you need illustrations, you need music tracks. If you've started any kind of project like that, you know how quickly you run into, well, if I want to sell this, I can't infringe copyright. So I got to find some music that I can use as a newsy theme that doesn't violate a copyright. Or I got to find a... Gosh, I wish I had a helicopter shot of Tokyo, but I can't hire a helicopter. How do I get that? Pond5 has all that kind of stuff. Establishing shots of big cities, audio of bombs ticking, images of palm trees, pandas, city skylines. I mean, whatever you can think of that you might need, go check out Pond5, and you can get it royalty-free. In other words, you tell them, I'm going to use it for this, and then you pay them one time. That's it.
Tom, so yes. Seriously, how long is it until we see the YouTube internet equivalent of Ed Wood? Because you remember Ed Wood just grabbed a bunch of just random footage from the archives and was able to stitch together, cobble together these narratives and make very, very cheap movies. I would love to see somebody do that within Pond5.
It's already happening. There's tons of video mashups out there. And you have to worry about, you know, oh, is this public domain or not? Unless you do something like Pond5. That gives you a much wider pool to choose from. Pond5 is a dynamic marketplace where you can also sell and upload your pro-quality content, set your own prices, and receive industry-leading royalties on every sale, which means that for media makers, the prices are unbeatable, and so is the range and quality of the content available. And because you're listening to Frame Rate, you're going to get 25% off your purchase this month when you use the coupon code TWIT25. So go right away, pond5.com, and use the offer code TWIT25, and we thank Pond5 for their support of Framerate. That's P-O-N-D, the number 5.com. I guess it's time for a slipstream. Woo! So, Ultraviolet, it's still around, hasn't left, and they're still pushing it. The industry says they've got 800,000 digital media locker accounts. They added 50,000 in the last 6 weeks. I believe that because it comes on a lot of DVDs. So if you sell a million movie discs, you're probably going to get, you know, a bunch of those people to sign up and try the ultraviolet thing. They also are working with Walmart to make it easy to sign up. So those people who can't figure out how to sign up can now bring in their DVDs to Walmart and say, hey, I want to get ultraviolet copies of this stuff.
You know, here's the problem that I see with this. And from a branding perspective, Netflix is a magical wonderland that you want to go to experience all these movies and TV shows. Hulu is a magical wonderland where you can see all the shows you missed last week and the week before. Ultraviolet is a dark room where you could go access the same movies you already own. And as a result, I perceive signing up for it to be a total chore.
In one way, it sounds brilliant, right? If this turns out to be true, you could bring your DVDs into Walmart and then you register digital copies. And when you go home, you have the ability to download an ultraviolet protected video of the DVD you already own. You didn't spend any extra money. Now you have the rights to it everywhere. It's dream come true. The question is ultraviolet going to finally work out its kinks so it's easy to play and easy to use and works? That's questionable. And how many people are really going to look at that box of DVDs and say, yeah, I got time to trug on down to Walmart and get these things all digitized up?
Well, like, and it's,
I can
it's
just
like,
do it. I just have the I own it. If I had the rights under the DMCA, I could just do it myself.
It's as though the product announcement was a giant letter from your grandmother reminding you that you really ought to organize all those discs you have. Yeah. And it's like, smell this. That's exciting for customers, you know?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, here's a chore that will allow you to do something that technology makes much easier, but we're not going to let you do that. Just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, I'll be really surprised as long as this is the way they're measuring accounts and as long as this is what the service is. This just seems like doing your taxes. Nobody's going to want to do it. Nobody's going to be excited about it. The best they can say is how relieved they are that they got it done and now they can finally watch the content they already bought the first time.
Wired has an article about the 12 most popular on Amazon's Prime Instant Videos. The most popular being The Bodyguard, which stars Whitney Houston. That's probably why, with Whitney Houston.
Unfair. Yeah, that's just happens to be this week.
Then it's Sky Pirates, followed by 12 Princesses, which is and those are both Amazon Studios films. That's where it gets interesting. You might expect something like The Bodyguard to be up at the top, but I think the idea that Amazon's original movies from Amazon Studios, which is kind of an experimental thing for Amazon, either says, people in Amazon Instant Prime are looking for new cool stuff, or no one's using Amazon Instant Prime.
It's funny because on the surface, this is exactly what you would expect. This is why you create original material, is so that it could be the most popular content on your network. But I think we're just all surprised. We're like, whoa, it worked. What?
They and Tim Carmody in this Wired article points out that Amazon Studios recent test movie awards helped goose their Amazon Studios stuff. So that these are all explainable through sort of random one-time events.
Yeah, I think
there's not a lot of people just going in and watching general movies.
Right. Well, and of course that's of course what they want. What they want is to be a destination right up there with Netflix and with Hulu. And maybe it'll happen. But for right now, I'm going to say in general, it's a bad thing specifically to the reason for each of those.
Let's move on to Tube Tops. Oh, this is a gorgeous idea. Greg Sandoval again over at CNET reporting that Fox and Warner Brothers are partnering with SanDisk and Western Digital to develop anti-piracy devices in an effort to secure 1080p high-definition movies once they're in the wild. The company has announced they have formed a consortium called the Secure Content Storage Association, SCSA. The group will create standards which they hope will be adopted by makers of Blu-ray players, tablets, and smart TVs so that when you buy a Blu-ray player, you can be secure in the knowledge that you won't be able to do anything fair use with it.
That's the funny part, man. Again, how do you sell this to the masses and get them excited about this?
It's essentially a way for them to sell high-definition movies, right? They're getting in their own way. They say, well, we'd love to sell high-definition movies, but we're afraid of piracy. So if we have these devices, these storage devices, that when you buy a Blu-ray movie online, it will actually stay high-def but stay anti-pirated, then we could do it. But what they're missing is these movies get pirated anyway. And if you're not selling them, as every industry has learned, you lose. That's not giving in. That's just a fact. And I just don't understand why they keep saying, you know what? The solution to this is to make it harder, to make it more difficult, give people less choices, and make it harder for them to buy the right thing. That's what this is.
The problem is there are certain ideas that you just cannot pitch in the boardroom. And the idea that you should lower your prices to meet demand and hit that sweet spot that will kill piracy and bring in the most amount of money, to go out there and say everyone should be able to buy movies for $2 and rent them for 50 cents, it's never going to happen. Nobody will stand up in the boardroom and say that.
Now, and here's the interesting thing, right? Netflix is out there saying, well, we can deliver high-def movies right now. People don't have to download them. People don't necessarily want to download them and buy them. So you can make money off it through us. But it's not as high quality as a Blu-ray disc, right? And it's not going to make as much money as the ability to kind of sell people collectibles. I get why they want to do this and not do Netflix, but they're going about it all wrong. There's a rumor today that Apple is developing a high-definition streaming service. Now, I don't know if this is true or not, but the idea is a good one. It says, with iCloud, all my music's in the cloud, they're going to develop a higher quality version of the songs we have today. And for those who want higher quality audio, you'll be able to, I don't know if you have to pay extra for it or you just have to pay your iCloud membership or whatever, you'd be able to get that remastered higher quality digital version. That's a great fight against piracy, where you never know how good a quality you're going to get if you download a song illegally. So why not pay right for it? Why don't you do that with high definition video? Get ahead of the pirates and say, nobody has this remastered high-quality version of it, but we will sell it to you and give you access to it and as part of a premium program where you pay and you stay ahead of the pirates. It's just – they're just –
Well, and likewise same thing. I'm Awesome in the chat room says, to stop all piracy, you have to make it impossible for any single person to make an illegal copy. That's not true. To stop piracy, what you need to do is make it a waste of your time and to bother to pirate material. For example, think about how people would hoard massive libraries of MP3s in the late 90s and early 2000s. And now Spotify, we've got Mog, we've got Pandora, we've got all these services to where whatever you want is available to you instantly, sometimes for free, other times at a very small cost. And it just seems stupid and a waste to hoard all of this content, and effectively that form of piracy gets killed because it's just no longer worth your time. You could do the same thing correctly with video as well.
All right, real quickly, TiVo announced their whole home DVR extenders are headed to retail. The device acts as an extender for a TiVo DVR hub, like the Premiere Elite, so you can stream your live and recorded programs in addition to providing access to internet apps like Netflix and Pandora. This is an example of getting it right. Like, I've recorded it. It's in my house. I should be able to watch it on whatever screen I want. And thankfully, with the TiVo extenders, you can. So just a little note about that. And then HBO Go coming to Xbox 360 on April 1st. What else is happening on April 1st, Brian?
It's Internet Christmas Day, where all of your favorite websites have new and unique content that they wrote just for you.
Oh, right, that's true. But I was thinking more of the premiere of Game of Thrones the next day.
Never heard of it. I look forward to it. Sounds like a fantastic program.
Well, when you subscribe to HBO and then your cable company allows it to be authenticated, you can watch it on your Xbox.
So I could go to my living room and turn on my television. But instead of turning on my Time Warner cable box and going to HBO On Demand, instead, I can load up my Xbox and go to HBO Go.
Well, if your Xbox is in a different room from your cable box, then that would make sense.
You know what? Actually, I'm going to say my stuff is in the same room side by side, but I actually will. I so vastly prefer the UI for Xbox over my stupid Time Warner box that I will do it just to not have to look at that stupid thing or use that stupid remote where I have to look at numbers and punch in codes for channels. What is this, 1943?
Yeah, I remember the 40s when there was no television in 1943.
Yeah, right. Well, okay, when you have to dial your radio program to listen to the audio adventures of Superman?
There was no radio. There was radio. Okay.
You would gather around the teletype and listen to the dots and the dits of your favorite short stories?
When you had to give the bard a 14-character hex code for him to sing you the song of the Odyssey? Remember those days?
It would cost you a full silver talent? Oh, my gosh. Those days were crazy.
All right. Let's move on to Film Found. We got a lot of stuff in Film Found today. See, this is my long-term vision for frame rate, Brian. I think I may have shared this with you before. Eventually, Film Found becomes the whole show. This is about watching things on the internet. Now, we have to tell you about Netflix, and we have to tell you about Xbox, and we have to tell you about TiVo, because the technology is catching up with the capability. And that's what the show is all about. But this week,
great, though.
This week, there's tons of good stuff to watch on the internet.
Absolutely, and I never thought about this. Maybe that's the nature of the fact that we're dealing with an emerging media means that at first the stories will be the technology, but nowadays we don't talk hardly at all about the technology behind television or film, because those are established, and now we're excited about content, and I want that to happen for the internet as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, Ridley Scott has a short film about Prometheus,
this is so good,
revealing the Whalen Corp's future. That was it actually played at the TED conference?
I don't know, but they portray it as though this is like TED 2023, and it appears to have the explicit endorsement of TED, because TED appears in the credits at the end. And it should be noted that this is the Wayland Corporation, which is the company that wanted to impregnate Ripley to bring her back to use the alien as a technology or whatever. They're the bad guys from the alien world. And Ridley Scott has gone on the record by explaining this is the only bridge that exists between the Prometheus story and the alien story, is the fact that that this company is the bridge between the two. So everyone else is rolling their eyes because a bunch of people are claiming that Prometheus is just alien redux. I don't know if that's the case or not, but I do know that this is a fantastic performance by Guy Pearce as this raspy voice, maniacal head of a corporation.
Peter Whalen is back.
Peter Whalen, there you go. Day after day.
Ad infinitum. All because he gave us fire. Our first true piece of technology. Fire. 100,000 BC, stone tools. 4,000 BC. The wheel, 9th century AD, gunpowder. Bit of a game changer, that one. 19th century, Eureka, the light bulb. 20th century, the automobile, television, nuclear weapons, spacecraft, internet. 21st century, biotech, nanotech, fusion and fission and M theory. And that was just the first decade. We are now 3 months into the year of our Lord, 2023. At this moment in our civilization, we can create cybernetic individuals who, in just a few short years, will be completely indistinguishable from us.
And hosting frame rate.
Which leads to an obvious conclusion.
Yeah, so you should definitely go and watch this entire thing. I got captivated just now. I just got lost in his voice. I wonder if it was a bad idea for TED to allow them to use their logo, because now I'm going to expect every TED talk to be that captivating.
I kind of love it. It reinforces the idea that TED is the land of extraordinarily polished, well-presented material. And in this case, it sort of hints that it doesn't matter if that material is your plan to ruin planet Earth. It will be beautiful and engaging and captivating, courtesy of TED.
Now, here's another good use of the internet. John Pavlis created a video that was blogged on Boing Boing by Maggie Kurth Baker. Because he was listening to the song Limited by a band called Joshua, and decided that it was telling him a story about a computer that wants to be friends but happens to be evil. Kind of the story of Portal, but told through using images from, I don't know, like a handful of sci-fi movies, most prominently HAL from 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Let's look at this for a little bit.
Once you spend a minute with it, everything is easy, oh my God. Everything is limited by factors inconceivable. Ah. Once you spend a minute with it, everything is easy, oh my God.
Whatever you can say, there's nothing left to do. Help is on the way, I'm waiting here with you. But someone's gotta say, I like you.
So,
it's a clever mixture. You obviously can see the 2001 A Space Odyssey, but there's also Moon by Duncan Jones,
yes.
RoboCop, Tron, and War Games mixed together to tell a totally new story.
I loved seeing all of those elements, but I felt like it never quite came together. The first half is way better than the second half. By the second half, it just sort of seemed to me like just a mishmash of random favorite best part. Like, you know, it's like you could tell these scenes don't really sync up. And it's just too jarring. I think it's a good idea that didn't quite hit the mark. But again,
I know what you mean. If you start to think about where that movie is from, where that scene is from, it kind of ruins it. But I still think that's only because you get so far in that you're starting
like
to think
right
about
here,
that
when,
stuff.
When all of a sudden you're showing the programs from Tron, like what is the context
They're
for that?
They're inside the computer. Like, they're inside the game.
All right.
He's
I don't
looking,
know.
And he's it, looking it, it, in.
Again, great idea. Kudos to you, but it gets too random near the end.
Also, an independent film shot in Pripyat, Ukraine, Pripyat probably, called Gamma, was actually shot in the ruins of Chernobyl and is a short movie about a nuclear cleanup project that goes awry. Let's watch just the very beginning of this.
This is gorgeous.
Fear not, the nuclear decade is over. Gamma. Here at Gamma, we are a family corporation. We can rebuild your city for a fee. But how? First, we sow our patented nuke roots across the land. They'll eat everything right down to the bedrock, pick out the nuclear nasties, and soak up all the radiation. A nuke what, you ask? Well, these little guys are your new best friends. They'll even build your city back good as new. Afterwards, we switch them off and bury them in a big old hole in the ground. By the magic of Gamma, your city awaits. Gamma.
They said it was safe. And we believed them.
Yeah, this is
Why
freaking
should we
gorgeous.
Not have gone home?
Now, it is very high concept. There's not much of a story. There's not a plot, I should say. There is a story told, but it's much more impressionistic. But you're seeing actual scenes from the Chernobyl area. And if you know what? What's funny is I watched the Anthony Bourdain special where he goes to Chernobyl. And I recognize some of the same places, like the kids' park, for instance.
Yeah, well, you know, there's been sort of a grim tourist industry for Chernobyl for a number of years. And, in fact, it's really fun if you go on YouTube and look up some of the individual tourists have gone around with their Geiger counters, avoiding the hot zones, exploring these areas. It's utterly fascinating because it's one of the few instances where essentially a human population has instantly vanished and you've been able to see nature reclaim a city bit by bit. And it's great that people are taking advantage of it for creative projects like this as well.
Moving on, because we got tons of stuff in Film Found today. This one, Ferris Bueller's Day Off Honda ad was a big popular ad during Super Bowl because it showed Matthew Broderick recreating some of the scenes of Ferris Bueller. But if you were sitting there like me going like, okay, that was a little different than the original as I remember it, this is the thing you got to watch. It is a side-by-side comparison from Aku TV showing the scenes from Ferris Bueller that are being recreated right next to the scenes from the Honda commercial.
Yeah, I don't know that we need to watch the whole thing, but I will say that one of the things that really stands out is you're right. Stuff that I remember, like, I don't quite remember it that way. It is pretty much shot for shot, very, very clearly, well, you know, well done side by side. But again, to me, all it did was, I don't know. I told you I was kind of annoyed by the ad to begin with, and I remain annoyed by the ad after seeing the side by side comparison. And it's hard for me to say why.
Another topic we've talked about quite a bit is what order you should view Star Wars in. There is a story up. Did you put this in?
I did. I snuck this in last minute. This is something that somebody sent to me earlier. The Star Wars Saga suggested viewing order. This is from Absolutely No Machete Juggling. It is perfect. Machete. The guy has cracked the code. He basically says the way you should watch the movies are, first of all, you should watch the high-definition recreations of the unaltered first three movies. And so basically, he said, watch them in chronological order. You screw up the greatest spoiler alert in all of history with Darth Vader being Luke's father. If you watch them in the traditional order, then you have a different problem in that it all of a sudden, okay, yeah, spoiler alert red, that Darth is Luke's father. All of a sudden, you've got this weird story that starts off being about Luke and turns into the story of Anakin, and all the surprises are ruined for the prequels because you know where everything goes. He says, watch Star Wars Episode IV, A New Hope. Watch The Empire Strikes Back. You get that awesome reveal about Anakin being Darth's father. Anakin's being Luke's father. Then go back and watch Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith. Don't even bother with Episode I. It's stricken from the face of the earth. The Phantom Menace is totally gone. And you get virtually no Jar Jar Binks this way. You get the backstory of the Clone Wars. You get the backstory of Anakin and his descent into becoming Darth Vader. And then when you go to Return of the Jedi, you get an improved context for his redemption at that point. And I got to tell you, if I'm ever going to show my kids the prequels, it's going to be in this context.
I think that's brilliant. That's a lovely way to kind of tie it up. And I always think of Return of the Jedi slightly different from the other two of the original three. Now, I do want to point out for people who don't know what you're talking about, the despecialized editions, the Blu-ray editions you mentioned at the very beginning of this story,
right,
are not official versions. They are a result of Harmy from the original trilogy forums reconstructing the three theatrical releases based on a wide variety of sources and even reconstructing some things with custom mats. It's not like you missed something and George Lucas released the original versions again. That's all.
That was another thing as well. If you watch just the original Return of the, you can't watch them in release order now either, because George Lucas made to screw that up as well. Because if you've never seen the prequels, you watch in a original order, then the last scene of the movie features Yoda, Obi-Wan Kenobi, and some really weird creeper young guy that you have no idea who the heck he is, because Anakin in.
No. But you know, if seeing Hayden Christensen at the end, it's not like when you saw Ray Milan at the end that he looked like the Darth Vader who was in the suit.
Yeah, he did.
He didn't.
To me.
It was pink mottled face. You knew it was the same guy because you're like, oh, it must be Darth Vader because, you know, process of elimination.
No, I bet somebody's going to send us an email on this one.
Oh, I'm sure, because you're upset about it. There's somebody else upset about it, but I just don't think it's a big deal.
All right.
What I do think is a big deal is that I think he's right that you leave out Episode I, but there's a part of me that loved the idea of Episode I. And I went and saw it three times when it first came out, trying to find the good in it. I knew there was good in Episode I of Star Wars, and I think Belated Media on YouTube has found it. You've got to watch, if you haven't already, What If Star Wars Episode I Was Good? And thanks to the folks who tweeted this to us, because several people tweeted and emailed it. Just check out the very beginning.
Let's go through this right now, and let's see all the points that work and don't work. And I'm going to rework it right now with you. So here, bearing in mind what George Lucas presented to all of us, we're going to get my version of Episode I. So here we go with What If. Now, the big thing whenever making a sequel or prequel, whenever you're revisiting a franchise, things need to feel old and new at the same time. Now, George made the misstep of thinking that familiarity meant characters. However, the same can be accomplished through theming and parallels. It also helps to have a main character. Episode 1 was very muddled in that regard. You aren't really sure who to point to, and it is really apparent who it should be. It's Obi-Wan's story, much as the way as the original trilogies were all about Luke. However, the overarching story will be about Darth Vader. With that in mind, we open.
So he goes through a lot of ways of keeping essentially the original story, but getting rid of the pieces that annoy. And I think he did a brilliant job.
There's little things that once you hear them, you can't lose it. Like, why on earth did they kill off Darth Maul if they could have had him assassinate Qui-Gon Jinn and then vanish and be just this menace out there, this driving force that Obi-Wan wants to get back at? And Obi-Wan is forced into raising Qui-Gon's pet project, who he doesn't really even like, but sort of builds up this begrudging respect for. I mean, there's all these. I'm telling you, I'm serious about this. I want to just keep rewatching this video until I truly believe this is how the Phantom Menace wins.
Yeah, I would like to see a re-edit somehow, if you could do that. I've always felt that Phantom Menace could be re-edited to be good, and I think there's a template here. A couple more things in Film Found. Tokyo Game Show 2012 is arguably better than E3, and it is definitely one of the biggest game shows in the world. Not game shows as in, like, you've just won a car, but, like, video games. It also is open to fans. So this year, they're actually going to stream a channel of the Tokyo Game Show. Now, they've been doing this for Blizzard's BlizzCon, which is just for fans of the Blizzard shows, on DirecTV and on the internet for several years. I think this is brilliant. Tokyo Game Show is going to make a mint on this, and they're going to be doing esports. They're going to be showing video game competitions as well.
Yeah, dude, this is fantastic. I'm very, very excited about this. And again, this is something we've all talked about forever, how online media and new media allows for people who are very passionate about individual small things and I'm not going to call this small by any stretch, but let's face it, this kind of content would never make it on a cable news station, and instead I think it's going to do very well in the live streaming space.
Yeah, and it's an example of someone who's starting from scratch going, well, I'm not going to go through old channels that I'm tied to. I'm going to go where my fans are. They're on the internet. I'm going to stream this on the internet. So September 20th through the 23rd, keep an eye out. Actually, I don't even know if they're going to charge from it. It's sort of unclear based on what I've read so far. And finally, The Walking Dead has announced a casting, and this is spoiler alert yellow. If you don't want to be spoiled about anything for the next season of Walking Dead, they have cast the role of the governor, and it will be David Morrissey.
Now, where have I seen David Morrissey before?
Doctor Who.
He's never heard of it. I look forward to it.
State of Play, Red Riding. He's a British actor.
He's British, man. Yeah. What is it with all the British taking our badass roles?
Yeah, well, we took their colonies, so we owe them something.
Fair enough, Britain. Enjoy them.
check it out. There's a story up on the New York Times. This is a real deal sort of thing. Next season. We get there. Now, that brings up a whole lot of questions about, really? We're going to hear about the governor already with the next season? What's going to go?
No, I think, to be honest, I am going to, in my mind, I'm going to wipe the entire second season. This entire second season, I'm giving you a one-time lost pass, Walking Dead. I don't care if the whole rest of this is as boring as the first half was. You got one season to win me back, and win me back you can. Given the two major themes that are obviously going to be in there, one being a new location that I think will be very interesting, and the other being a new character and a showdown that I think will be very interesting. There's no reason you can't win me back next year, but for right now, you're on my bad list, Walking Dead.
All right, let's check out what's premiering this week.
Premiering this week! This is what's premiering this week! Check it out!
This is why we don't do the movie draft at this time of year. Project X, which is a movie about kids putting on a party and then it turning bad, and Dr. Seuss's The Lorax.
Yeah, I mean, we got some comments on The Lorax in feedback coming up.
It's a Dr. Seuss movie, whatever. But it's not core to the cut. But good news is Dan sent us a preliminary lineup for the summer movie draft. Did you see that, Brian?
Yes, I did. I'm very, very excited about it. We got to figure out when we're going to have our next showdown. And of course, this last time, I think we had over 500 people from the chat room play along with us. And keep in mind, if you want to have a dog in the fight, make sure to join us when we do our big auction and play the game.
Yeah, absolutely. The movies start in April, so we'll be doing our draft sometime in March, yet to be determined. Yep. I actually sent him some alternate movie titles this time, so we're not sitting around going like, well, why didn't we include this movie?
Because that's how we talk when we complain. We go,
now it's time for what we're watching.
Now it's time for what we're watching.
And you're only watching one thing?
Yes, Tom, now that you've asked me, yes, the Scam School book is launching in just 2 weeks. This book has certainly not taken up all of my time for the last 3 weeks nonstop.
Brian,
and you can be able to get it for what?
Not what we're launching.
Oh. No, the only thing I've managed to see was Lilyhammer, and that was when my brain got fried. And I was like, I'm going on break for 1 hour, and I sat down and watched Lilyhammer.
All right. So you didn't watch Walking Dead this week then?
I did not. How was it?
I liked it, but I have liked episodes that you haven't liked this season, and this is a slower episode, so I'm not certain you're going to like it.
All right.
However,
we'll see.
The big saving grace for me, even though it moved a little slowly, was that the relationship between Rick and Shane has really come to a head. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, I look forward to experiencing it.
I also
watched the Oscars.
Yeah, I did watch the Oscars. I don't know why I throw that on there. I mean, I watch the Oscars every year. It was more entertaining this year. I think they get more entertaining every year. They put in more movie info. When they announce the nominees, especially for trade categories like cinematography, they try to give you some insights into cinematography, and I like that. Overall, I thought it was pretty good. Billy Crystal, he's starting to get like Bob Hope. Like, he's been doing it off and on for so long. But, it was fine. I like tradition. So I was happy to see the show. I'm more excited to talk about Star Trek Phase 2, or The New Voyages, because I finally finished their entire 6-episode run. They've got a new episode coming out soon. There's a trailer out for it, a teaser also. So besides the trailer, there's also a teaser that gives you, like, the first few minutes of the episode. That show, I was always impressed with it from the beginning, right? The acting was, it was okay. But the sets were amazing, the scripts were amazing, and the acting has caught up with it. As they've gotten going, they've replaced a few people. A few people have really grown into the roles, and they continue to have fantastic guests. They had George Takei at one point. They had Walter Koenig, who played Chekhov at one point. And they also have some less famous guests, unless you're a Star Trek fan, who's sort of like, oh, wait a minute, I think that's Barbara Luna. She's the girl that played the captain's girl in the alternate universe. And now she's the villain. And they have lots of great inside jokes about that stuff. The show just keeps getting better and better. And the best part is these folks are doing it for love. They basically just ask for your donations. And when they get enough money, they put out the next episode.
So how rare is it that you get the implicit endorsement of a studio to do this kind of fan fiction experiment? I mean, can you imagine Lucas approving this kind of thing? Can you imagine?
Yes, I can.
That's
one thing that Lucas is very good about is approving fan art and fan fiction sort of stuff.
And is that a rarity across the board, or do you think we could possibly see more of this for other franchises as well?
I think bigger franchises that have a louder fan base have a better chance of getting approval. I think it's when you do something that's less popular that the studios don't have anybody fighting for it on the content side, and so the lawyers just go into lawyer mode, and they're like, shut it down. But when you got something like Star Trek, you get CBS's attention, and they're like, this is a really valuable property. It's a very active fan base. If we fight this, I think studios have learned their lesson that if it's a big enough fan base, fighting it makes it worse. And so, props to CBS for being willing to let these guys use intellectual property, use music from the show, use the names and all of that stuff. And all they do is they put up a big slate saying, hey, these are the properties of CBS. We don't pretend to own them. We're using them with their permission, but they can take that permission back anytime they want. So, big thanks to them. But the Star Trek universe of the professional people who created Star Trek have embraced them as well. David Gerrold co-wrote an episode. DC Fontana, one of the consulting producers and writers from the original series, wrote an episode. You see a lot of the stars willing to come back. So it's not even just the studio. It's the whole community of Star Trek. That's what makes it
cool. All right. So right now, these Star Trek stories, they are going to live in the they're sort of like Remora attached to the giant shark of the Star Trek franchise. I'm going to make a prediction that if someone enterprising out there wants to get a jump on it, they could create a Firefly series in the same Firefly universe, different story, different group of people, same universe, and this thing. There is so much built-up love for the Firefly universe that it would be idiotic for them to try to shut it down. They could, theoretically, tell stories as engaging as the original show, and they could create a more successful, longer-running franchise in the beloved universe than the original run of Firefly itself.
You mean like Browncoat's Redemption?
How long is that? How many episodes do they have? Is that good?
It's a movie. It's a sequel. Movie. It's not an entire run. You're saying go full on TV series.
Yeah. Well, I'm saying just start putting them out on YouTube, build up the love, and let the lawyers hash it out after the fact.
Because Joss Whedon has totally supported the Browncoats in their fan films, and they've got new projects all the time. So that's happening.
Yep.
It may not.
I think that could happen.
I think it is. No, it was at Browncoat Junction.
No. I'm saying not just a one-off movie. I'm saying somebody could make a series and have it continue to live and thrive in the YouTube universe.
I think that sort of. I don't know. I think what the Browncoats have decided is movies are just as hard to make as 1-hour episodes. So call them what you will.
All right.
But yeah, I think you're absolutely right, and I think that's happening. I'm sure we'll get emails telling both of us we don't know what we're talking about.
Speaking of which, let's look at feedback.
Now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate. Oh, yeah.
Anthony Marban wrote in and said, last week you mentioned the quality of DVR recordings is double compressed. This is not the case with digital content. When you record The Walking Dead in HD, all that is happening is the DVR is copying over the bits to your DVR's hard drive. When you record standard def content, or you use some sort of analog conversion like the Halpage HD PVR, then there would be double compression. You also mentioned the over-the-air content is at a higher quality than over cable. This is not true for Verizon Fios. Verizon pipes over the full data stream that comes over the air. Verizon is less constrained by bandwidth than regular cable providers, so they don't bother recompressing. Anthony, I don't know if what you're saying about DVRs and digital content is true for all services, but you may be right about some, and I know he is right about Verizon. So feel good about yourself. Give yourself a big pat on the back.
Yeah, we also, former guest on the show, Derek Chen, wrote in a very long letter talking about the targeted advertising. Of course, he's very hip to what's going on in this space. And he mentions a few specifics, and I wish I could read you the whole letter. And in fact, we ought to hit up Derek and see if we can be allowed to include his full letter in the show notes. But he says, you can target specific shows that you know are popular in certain demographics, but we're just not there as far as the ability to target specific ads to specific demographics and deliver them dynamically the way I was speculating we should be able to. Now, and I will say this, Derek, even if that's true today, there's no way it's going to be still true 5 years from now. There's too much money on the line. They've got to figure out a way to do this.
Derek,
but my favorite paragraph.
What? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. My favorite paragraph was where he talks about the several different services, and he mentions YouTube, which, and this is his words, which dominates the landscape when it comes to videos watched, has its own set of challenges too. Yes, they're building on original programming, but the content is still early. Even amongst yourselves, I'm sure you can name several more original shows from Fox or ABC than you can on YouTube. Why is that important? Well, you have to keep in mind that television most often is used for branding and mass reach. That's why ratings have become so important. We still need to come to that point where an original online show gets the amount of water cooler talk that we see with American Idol, Glee, and Fringe every week. It's hard to convince the client, and for them, their bosses and marketing teams, to invest in shows that they've never heard of. Furthermore, YouTube, despite being a video site, has yet to develop in-stream video ad spots, mid-rolls. For the most part, what they focus on is pre-rolls and TrueView. TrueView are those click-out-after-5-second ads. And after that, it overlays and companion banners Plus, most of the time, running on YouTube is more about running CPC across keyword targeted video and content. I guess that's cost per click. And I can't even tell my client when they are guaranteed to see their spot, quote unquote, air. I can only hope our bid gets into the right video at the right time for the right video. It's not that YouTube isn't an efficient driver of clicks, views, etc. It just becomes more of a competitor to online display media than it is for television budgets.
Okay, Derek, first of all, obviously you haven't been initiated into this secret realm. So they haven't showed you all the secret technologies where they can target ads directly at each of us based on our moods.
Yes.
No, I forgot to mention that. He's right. We often tend to think that targeting, because it theoretically could be this way, has to be that way out of paranoia or conspiracy, when in fact targeting is not nearly as good as it should be. So that's a fair point. I think it's a sad point, but it's a true point, what he's saying about the client saying, well, wait a minute, I've never heard of that. So many times they don't care about the numbers. They don't care about the research. They don't care about the demographics. They care about the perception. If Glee is well known and their kids know it, they're more likely to buy it. And that's just human nature, and that's the sad thing about sales. It isn't always about numbers. I mean, I learned that the hard way at Tech TV. The Screensavers was by far the most popular show on Tech TV, but the network was constantly trying to make something else more popular because it just didn't resonate with the advertisers and the agencies. And we could go into a long psychological discussion about why, but it was just one of the sad facts that the numbers don't always sell. Finally, YouTube, I know, is going to change the way they're selling ads with this new project they've got rolling out, where they're funding all these different channels. So Derek may get some of his wishes here. But the fact that a client can't be guaranteed to see their spot air, that's no different than saying I can't be guaranteed to see when my banner ad's going to show up. I mean, we'll get over that. They'll show up.
Right. Yeah, that is a short-term complaint that you're going to have. And let me state for the record that the TrueView phenomenon is awesome, dude. The TrueView is the best innovation to happen to YouTube advertising. The ability, like, if you're relaxed and don't care and you're interested in the ad, you'll sit and watch the preview. Because I've done it several times with video games. But then meanwhile, I'm trying not to laugh at the animated Brian squirming. I love the TrueView experience.
And any day, Brian will get out of those ropes. Finally, Chuck Byers writes in and laments the Lorax movie. He's a big fan of the book. He's a big fan of an animated version of Lorax that was approved by Geisel in the 70s. It's 22 minutes, 40-year-old cartoon. They read it's practically word for word from the book. They own it on DVD. The remake, he is very upset about, not only because it's a CGI version, but he says, from what I've seen of the previews, there's practically nothing from the book in this thing. Taylor Swift voices a girl who wants to see a real tree. Where did she come from? Do they think kids are that stupid today that they need to lead them into a story like this with an extra character? I can see needing to pad the story to make it the 90-minute length, which seems to be the standard today. But in my opinion, they should not have made this one at all. What's next? A computer-animated version of Charlie Brown's Christmas, where the kids have to get to the North Pole to find the real Santa Claus? I, for one, am not going to give any of my hard-earned money to this one. There. Said my piece.
All right. So tell me if you agree with me on this one. And first of all, I understand emotionally where you're coming from, Chuck. But the fact is, that 22-minute version of it has no place on primetime television in the 21st century. There's no way for it to exist. What your experience with that is your experience. And your kids are going to have a different experience. So you really have two choices. You can either preserve this as an artifact from the past that you ask your kids to enjoy on its own merits, or it can be this the Lorax. And I would rather have more Dr. Seuss in the modern vernacular, in the modern way kids understand movies.
It's all a matter of taste. And Chuck's absolutely – it's absolutely fair for Chuck to not like the new movie because he loves the old one so much. It's also possible that some people will like both. And it's possible that some people don't like your 22-minute version and won't like the movie. I mean, all these things are possible. It can go both ways, right? You can remake the Avengers television series, not the comic book characters, but the British spy television series with Emma Peel. You can remake that and have it be awful. And that will sorely disappoint someone like me who loves that television series. Or you can make Lord of the Rings. And there are people who absolutely love the animated version of Lord of the Rings from the 70s. But they still also love the Lord of the Rings movie version that was made recently by Peter Jackson. So it all depends on whether you make that second one good or not. And I guess that's to be seen.
And having said all that, even for all its changes and stuff, and of course I'm not so worried about desecrating the original Lorax, I know my kids are interested in seeing it, and I'm excited to go watch it with them.
All right. You're not worried about the message it sends about liking trees?
Yes, I'm very, very worried. No, I'm not worried.
All right, that's it for this episode of Frame Rate. As I mentioned, if you like watching the show live, or maybe you couldn't watch the show live because of the time it was on, it's moving time starting next week, March 6th. We will be on at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern at live.twit.tv. That still works, but just twit.tv. Andy Beach is going to join us next week, and he's going to try to explain all this compression, Mozilla, DRM, and the HTML5 stuff to us. And mostly, it turns out, it's just a religious battle. So, framerateshow@gmail.com. We'll see you next time.